My name's Yana Gallen. I'm an assistant professor here at the Harris School. And my research focuses on gender inequality, and that's what I'm going to talk to you about today. So I'm particularly interested in understanding the sources of the gender wage gap. What is that gap? Kind of as a start, there are a lot of numbers thrown around, but if you compare the average pay of women and men in the United States, you see that women are paid about 30% less than men. Now, once you start to think about the fact that we might want to incorporate women, you know, working fewer hours than men, women generally being in different occupations than men, then kind of comparing women and men in the same occupations, working about the same hours, you can get the gap down to about 20%, so women being paid 20% less than men. If you have maybe better data, you can start thinking about women and men in the same firm in a really narrow kind of occupation category. And if you put in all of the controls, as we call them, that you can, you see that the gap falls to 15%, maybe 10% is kind of the lowest that I've seen it go. So there's still this very persistent gender wage gap. And that's true in the United States, so it's about, you know, 20% in the United States when you kind of control for occupation and hours worked. In countries like Denmark, Norway, Sweden, so places that we think of as very egalitarian in the gender dimension and in many other ways, you see that that gap is as large in those places. So in Denmark, the raw difference between the average pay of women and men is also about 30%, close to 30%. And why do I mention Denmark? All of my research uses Danish data because they don't have as many privacy concerns as we do here, and they put a lot of data together for researchers to work with that are extremely detailed. So in the Danish data, you can see kind of how many hours somebody has worked over their lifetime. You can see exactly what occupation they're in, exactly what firm they're in, follow people over time. And you can use that information to ask, you know, how much of this gender pay gap is due to occupational differences between men and women? How much is due to hours differences? How much is due to experience lost while you're taking care of children for a year or two, as you're entitled to there? And what you see is that, you know, even in this place where women are a large fraction of the labor force, a pretty persistent 15% pay gap is there for women in the same firm, in the same occupation as men. Okay, so understanding the sources of that, you know, it doesn't seem to be just occupational sorting, is really important for what kind of policy we want to design. If it were all about what occupations women were doing, what firms women are working in, that would kind of suggest certain policy interventions that are quite different than what you see in the data. So what you see in the data is that motherhood is really important. So a lot of papers that you see now have motherhood and the gender gap in the title in some way, shape, or form. And that's because this is kind of a plot using US data of what happens on average to women's earnings in the year that they have their first child. This does not happen for men's earnings, by the way. Men's earnings stay pretty flat around that event. But what you see for women is that there's a pretty dramatic drop in their earnings and in their hours worked, about 40% on average, in the year that they have their child. And there's no real recovery. I mean, there's no long-run recovery. So this is using the PSID in the United States. And there have been papers written that do the same exercise with Danish data. And you see exactly that drop right when you have a child. That's when you see a big decline in your earnings. And that's the group of people that are contributing to this like very large gender pay gap. So the gap is smaller for women without children and early in their career. So what is the source of that big gap for mothers? In Danish data, you can kind of look more closely to try and understand that, and you see that it's about equal parts kind of changes to different occupations or moving to the public sector in particular, which is lower pay, and working less, so fewer hours, and also stepping out, you know, of the labor force to take care of a child. But I guess the interesting takeaway is that even there, when you can look like 15 years after your first child is born, you don't see that women kind of recover. So this earnings drop that happens around the time that you have children is permanent. And so it's not just a cost of taking care of your child in those first few years and then you kind of get back into it. It seems like this stays with women. So what is happening with mothers? I think that's an important question for understanding how to address the major sources of the gender pay gap. Is this all about choices that women are making? They're choosing to work, do different jobs, and spend less time at work and be less engaged kind of in work? Or is it that employers recognize that women aren't able to change jobs as easily once they have children, and they start to kind of take advantage of that and pay women less? So I have a paper which kind of, tries to answer that. So it's trying to understand the sources of the motherhood penalty, and in particular, whether part of this is, how much is explained by productivity differences between mothers and women without children, and how much seems to be about other stories that are, that people do mention as sources, potential sources of the gender pay gap, like women's are less able or less inclined to negotiate for raises than men, but they're doing the same work and employers are able to pay them less. So is that what's happening, or is this about differences in the kind of work that women are doing, especially once they become mothers? So using Danish data, another nice thing about the Danish data is, again, that you can link these records at the firm level to what the firm is producing, and you can ask, you know, are firms that are employing a lot of women producing less than firms that are employing a lot of men? If that's true, then that would suggest that there are actual differences in the work that women are doing, and that that big gender pay gap is in part explained by differences in output, kind of for women who have children versus women that don't and versus men. So what you see is exactly that, that the productivity gap, I'll call it, is kind of large for mothers, and it's in line with the pay gap. So mothers are about 20% less productive than men, and they're paid 20% less. And a lot of that, I will speculate here, I don't have good Danish data on hours worked, but I think a lot of it is actually just unmeasured hours worked. There's a lot of difference in how much full-time employees actually work, but they're all classified as working 37 hours a week. And so it's, and then, you know, in any data set, it's really hard to control for details about how much time you're spending at work and how much work you're actually doing. In the time use surveys in the US, you do see a pattern consistent with that. So if you just look at full-time women compared to full-time men, you see that women work, in particular mothers work, on average 5 hours less per week than men. So a lot of this is probably to do with choices that women make around the time that they become mothers. What you see is that women without children are as productive as men, and they're still paid less. So, and this is particularly true during when they're young. So this is particularly true for young women without children. So this is the wage gaps by kind of parenthood status, male versus female, and by age. And what you see is that women are definitely paid less than men, and that mothers are particularly paid less than women without children. So mothers are generally the least paid group. But women without children also have about a 10% pay gap compared to men. That's not true at all. That's not the picture that you see at all when you measure productivity. So I'll say that that the points near the end get very noisily estimated. But what's economically and statistically kind of significant in this graph is that the that there's a large productivity gap for mothers compared to women without children. And women without children seem to be as productive as men, particularly when they're young. So they're kind of this replacing a man with a woman who doesn't have children at a firm seems to have no effect on its output. But the same is not true for mothers. For mothers, it seems like they're substantially less productive than women without children and men. Okay, and that difference is particularly pronounced in their prime childbearing years. So the largest gap for women without children between pay and productivity happens when they're young. So what story is this data kind of consistent with? It's consistent with a story in which women decrease their hours or change occupations or start doing different work for the firm when they become mothers. And we can talk about what kind of policy solutions might address that if we want to change that. We can talk about accommodating women with children to be as productive as they as possible when they have children, and maybe they want to spend less time in the actual firm. And we can talk about remote work and things like that. But what you see is that there's also this, you know, big gap between pay and productivity, particularly for women without children. And for that group, it seems like maybe the data is consistent with a story where firms know that these women are going to have children soon, or expect that they're going to have children soon, but it's not possible to just lower these women's wages right when they have children, even if they start leaving at 4 o'clock to pick up their kids from daycare. So instead, they kind of lower the wages of all women in anticipation of this event, so that your wage profile is pretty smooth over this period, you know, relative to this productivity. So I think motherhood is really important for understanding what women are doing at work and also for explaining earnings. This research is just kind of one of the papers that is consistent with that story. And we kind of know that, I think policymakers also know that. So a lot of policy that somehow related to the gender pay gap is about motherhood. Examples are parental leave, job protection for women when they have children. But I will say that parental leave was first introduced to get women kind of out of the labor force. So when men were kind of returning to work after World War II, the idea of a lot of countries introduced parental leave policies, so they would pay women after they had children in order to kind of get them out and give their positions to men. But eventually, countries did start to want to increase women's labor force participation, so that's when job protection began to be accompanying this paid leave. So job protection means that you have the right to go back to your same job after you have children, and you would think that that would increase women's attachment to their firm and be beneficial for the long-term kind of labor prospects of mothers. We also have other policies that we can think about, like encouraging hours flexibility for all workers, including remote work options for mothers. But a common theme with these policies is that they are targeted towards mothers, and when you target mothers, it might be true that the same kind of statistical discrimination, as we call it, that I talked about before would affect all women, in anticipation of them becoming mothers. So we can think about kind of alternative policy choices compared to these policies. So again, historically, maternity leave is an example of a policy that was intended to get women out of work. It does have this feature that, you're paid while you're not working, which makes not working very attractive for that period of time. Later, job protection was added. But I have research which asks the question, do firms like these policies? Is there any chance that firms might discriminate against women because these long leaves are costly? So again, I used Danish data to study the question, are these parental leaves costly to firms? And for most firms, there's no evidence that they are. So for most firms, for relatively large firms, you don't see any evidence that it's difficult to substitute a worker while they're on leave. But for small firms, you see some evidence that they're more likely to be gone 5 years after a woman takes a long leave compared to women that didn't have that option. There's also a working paper by Malika Thomas, which points to possible effects on early investments in women. So I think this is a growing area of research that there's a lot of interest in. How much do firms react to these policies by not investing in women who are going to be kind of not super attached to the firm in the long run? And how do these policies encourage women who are not planning on staying in the firm to kind of distort their choices early on in their career? If that's true, then it might be the case that women who are very career oriented are discriminated against just based on the possibility that they have children. So we have to think about these kind of unintended policy consequences for all women at work when we think about making time away from work really attractive for women who just had children. So what are alternatives? So Sherman Rosen has a great paper, a couple of papers many years ago, which thinks about the success kind of the Nordic model for getting women into the labor force. And what he argues is that these countries have policies which are what we'd call complements to working. So in particular, early childcare, and providing early childcare is something that, instead of encouraging women to take a lot of time out of the labor force, encourages women to send their kids to school, and then what else have you got to do with your time? You might as well be working. So these kinds of policies, I think, are you know, an alternative that might help women stay attached to the labor force, in particular coupling things like job protection for folks when their kids are sick and they have to take care of them with this kind of policy might be particularly effective and wouldn't have this feature of really differentiating the career paths of mothers from men. So there's kind of limited and conflicting research, I think, on the early childcare effects for children. So, you know, in terms of national evaluations, there's a good amount of evidence from Canada and Norway that early childcare is really helpful for children of low-income parents, that it's great to get them into, you know, a childcare center. But these effects turn negative. Very recent research suggests that these effects turn negative for children of very advantaged families. So I think that, you know, whenever we're thinking about these policies, of course, we have to think about the possible consequences for all women of policies that target mothers, even though we do see that motherhood is a big source of the pay gap. But also, we can start thinking about policies that make mothers look more like men who have children in the workplace. Those policies probably involve providing a lot of childcare, and I think that there's a lot of work to be done to evaluate how that affects children and how that affects women's careers. So I think that's kind of the frontier of this kind of research. My big takeaways from this talk, I guess, that motherhood is a place where big gender pay gaps emerge. It seems like women, when they become mothers, do make different choices in their jobs than men when they become fathers, and they start to look different than women without children. When we think about policies that try to make working easier for mothers, there might be an unintended consequence of that if those policies in any way disadvantage firms or make women less attached to the labor market in general, that all women might have lower wages as a result of that, which is obviously not the point of that policy. I think that possible solutions include subsidizing things that are complements to work for women rather than trying to get women out of the labor force and trying to make that easier. So I think a lot more work is needed. We actually know very little about the gender pay gap, even though it's been there for a long time and it's large. So this is a very exciting area of research, and thanks for listening.